Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Industrial Energy Efficiency Dialogue Towards a Sustainable Future. I am Sumedha Avasthi, Project Manager, International Institute for Energy Conservation. And for today's webinar, we are using the GoToWebinar interface for conducting this dialogue. And I would like to inform you that this webinar will be recorded and your recording will be available after the webinar is over. We will keep your microphones and webcams on mute so that there's no disturbance. And during the webinar, if you have any questions, on the right side, you'll see a panel which has the comments and the question session. You can keep posting your questions on that. And at the end of the webinar, we will have a question answer round during which we will take up all the questions. Now, I would first like to welcome all my speakers. Firstly, we have with us Mr. S.P. Garnayak, Executive Director, EESL, Dr. Anand Shukla, AGM, EESL, Mr. Manoj Kumar, Project Manager, EESL, Mr. Abhishek Duper, ICA, Mr. Sanjay Dubey, CEO, IIEC. So I would like to thank all the speakers and the participants to take out time from the busy schedule and joining us for this dialogue. So firstly, a bit about this webinar, what was the aim behind this? So EESL along with IIEC is conducting this webinar with key industry and corporate leaders of the northern and western part of the country to share and discuss the innovative energy efficiency mechanisms and schemes along with success stories to initiate the dialogue and provide support in overcoming the technical and financial barriers in the implementation of energy efficiency. So this webinar aims to establish a mechanism where the industries and corporates can work with EESL for the design and implementation of EE programs in the future. So without taking much time, I would like to invite Mr. Manoj Kumar, Project Manager, EESL, to give the welcome address.
Thank you, Sumedha. Am I audible? Sumedha, am I
yes,
audible?
Yes, sir, you are.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, a warm good morning to all of you who have gathered here. Hope all your dear and near ones are safe and healthy during these testing times. It is my pleasure and an honor to deliver the welcome address. As you might be aware, Energy Efficiency Services Limited, a company under the Ministry of Power, have been working strenuously in the field of energy efficiency. EESL is implementing the world's largest energy efficiency portfolio across sectors like lighting, buildings, electric mobility, smart metering, cooling, and agriculture DSM at a scale. Over the last few years, EESL has been diversifying its portfolio to focus on industrial and commercial sector and has initiated relevant programs and projects. Energy efficiency has become even more important now during this COVID-19 situation and can be a very important and potential tool to reduce the OPEX cost and sail through the tough times. During this journey since the last few years, we understand the necessity and usefulness of regular interaction with the industry stakeholders to understand their needs and thought process and possible areas of collaboration. With this objective, we have been conducting a series of workshops and focus group discussions with many relevant stakeholders. And with changing times, we are doing such events, such focus group discussions through web platform. Today's event is being held under the aegis of a global environmental facility project, which is being implemented by EESL in association with United Nations Environment Programme and ADB, with the objective to promote and sustain energy efficiency markets in India. Without further ado, I would like to extend a warm welcome to Mr. S.P. Garnayak, Executive Director, EESL, to this event. Mr. Garnayak has been spearheading such initiatives since his PE days, and it would be enthusing to listen to him. I would also like to welcome the panelists, Dr. Anand Shukla, who would be discussing about EESL Super Efficient Program, and Mr. Abhishek Duper, who would be discussing about National Motor Replacement Program. I also welcome Mr. Sanjay Dubey, CEO, IIEC India, who are supporting EESL for the conduct of this event. I also like to welcome all EESL and other colleagues from partner agencies who have joined this event from different locations. Last but not the least, I welcome all participants who have taken out their precious time and have joined this webinar to take forward the energy efficiency dialogue to the next level. I once again extend a warm welcome to all and look forward to interacting with you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Over to you, Sumedha.
Thank you so much, Mr. Manoj, for the insights and the welcome address. Now, I would like to invite Mr. Sanjay Dubey to set the theme for the discussion. Over to you,
Thank
sir.
You, Sumedha. Thank you, Sumedha. Good morning to everybody. And as Mr. Manoj rightly said, I would also like to check and wish that, you know, all of you should maintain safe living in this crucial time. And I hope that you and your loved ones are safe and remain safe and we sail through this tough time all together. You know, but we can't hold on our activities. So we all are working and then using these kind of platforms to basically communicate with each other, which I think is also a very right way to do that. I mean, long back, you know, Mr. Ghannayak and I discussed about, you know, how to reach out to the larger, you know, the stakeholders in India to promote, you know, the, you know, effective implementation of energy conservation or energy efficiency aspects, and also, you know, the, you know, the services and the equipments and things that in the EASL is extending to the market. And as a result, you know, we basically designed this program, and now we are talking to you. And all of us should know that, you know, when we learn about energy efficiency many years back, you know, all our gurus always used to talk like, you know, energy efficiency is not something that you can, you know, achieve and stop. It is a journey, you know, that it starts and it continues. You know, you reach a level, then you optimize, and then you reach to the next level, then you further optimize, and you keep learning while doing so. You know? So there is always a you know, effort that is keep going on at your level. And the most important aspect is the data and actually the, you know, use of the data to basically monitor, you know. So for this particular, you know, area, monitoring and verification and, you know, baselining, these kind of activities are very, very important. There's a theory that the entire world follow that, you know, conduct energy audit and implement different energy conservation and efficiency measures. That is also a good way to do that, but you know, we always promote, you know about your you know, requirements, then you jump to any kind of an audit or any kind of a requirement from the market, you know. Otherwise it'll be a report that will basically accumulate and store it somewhere. It may not be implemented. So you know, achieve low cost, no cost, go for better energy efficiency measures, keep implementing, keep optimizing, keep sharing data, and keep educating the people, because it's a teamwork. You know, if you talk about industry, if you talk about buildings or corporate or offices, anywhere you know, try to implement energy efficiency, that, you know, the 2-3 aspects that play a major role. One is your own team, you know. So it's not necessary that, you know, your building engineer or your you know, chief engineer of the industry, you know, or the management of the industry is responsible. No, everybody is responsible to achieve something, you know. That is the most important message that one should receive. Secondly, you know, the equipments or appliances, whatever that is being utilized, should be energy efficient, because, you know, there's a limit that you can do through switch off light or through, you know, managing your processes. It's important that we should utilize those kind of equipments and appliances which themselves are energy efficient. And in this drive, ESL has started playing a greater amount of role. And actually, it is the real practice toward market transformation that they are taking care of. You know, so they're working in all sectors, and they're promoting different technologies and processes and systems, so that, you know, we all get benefited in. And one of this movement today, you know, some of the knowledge, I mean, there's a limit to transfer in 1 hour's time, but some of that knowledge will be transferred through Mr. Ghannayak and through Mr. Anand Shukla, so that, you know, you get benefit. But I will highly encourage you all to, you know, continue your dialogue with ESL after this webinar, so that, you know, you can get to know about the services and equipments and air conditioning and lighting and various aspects and models that they have designed. And please implement them, you know, because unless you adopt them, you'll not see the results, you know. So seeing is believing. Go to that direction. This is what is the main purpose of, you know, talking to everybody today. And this is a dialogue, you know. So we basically will encourage encourage you to, you know, ask questions, you know, clear your doubts. And if time is not sufficient today, maybe you can shoot an email to us or, you know, Manojji or somebody at the ESL to know more. But we have to be part of this movement, and then only energy efficiency can achieve. And, you know, so there are many services, and I will not take much time because Mr. Ghannayak is here. He will be the best person to tell you about that, and then Anandji, and then Abhishek about the motor program. ICA is doing great amount of work in terms of promoting energy efficient equipments and appliances in India, through bringing more efficiency. So these models, we are lucky enough to hear them today and learn about that. Thank you so much. Over to you, Sumedha.
Thank you, sir. And as rightly said, please keep posting your comments on the section on the right side, and we will be taking them at the end of the session. And now I would like to invite Mr. S.P. Karnayak to give the keynote address on ESL's Integrated Energy Efficiency Services approach. Mr. Karnayak is presently serving as an Executive Director and Business Unit Head at ESL. During his 25 years of professional career, Mr. Karnayak has served in government, bilateral and international organizations at various capacities in the field of energy policy, energy management and resource conservation. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Sumedha, and welcome everyone, those who have joined in this virtual meeting. I hope I'm audible to all of you, and I again, as my both previous speakers told, I can wish all of you, your near and dear ones, a very happy and healthy life as we are passing through a very, very difficult time. Thanks to IIEC for organizing this webinar, which we have been discussing since last couple of months, to reach out to a larger audience on the model which ESL has precisely developed, conceptualized, that is on the integrated energy efficiency model. And some of the success stories are also there in the place. In the last couple of years, we have tried to implement this at the ground level at various end users, and very, very encouraging results have been obtained. So, ladies and gentlemen, again, thanks all of you to join this, and let's just to understand that how we are actually as an ESL, as a company, as a service provider in the energy efficiency area, how we are actually going to address this particular issue and bring or try to bring that solution at your doorstep. People talked about the lightings, the motors, and maybe air conditioners and so on and so forth. Probably you may have that option that we know all these things. What is new in this? So that is exactly the point of contention here, discussion here. The idea here is that if the technologies are known, but the access to the technology with a good business model is the key to the success. Each new technology, as you may be knowing much better than anybody else, because you are handling your energy resources at your places in a day in and day and out basis. So the idea here is that once you go for managing or optimizing your resources and all, you have to manage it or reduce your wastage to the greater extent. That requires either the experience, the way you are doing since long, maybe some judicious or logical analysis, which Mr. Dubey has already highlighted, to conducting some energy audits or diagnostic studies to find out where the energy saving options are, and then going forward to the further implementation. Now, the point is that the energy audits which are done by experts, outside experts, or even your internal own people, probably they come out with certain solutions, but that certain solutions, unless otherwise it is taken into the next level of implementation, it remains on paper only. And I'm sure many of the industries, those who are under the PAT regime also, a PAT umbrella, they are also doing a lot of interventions to reach to that targets which have been fixed by the government of India to them. But at the same time, also many of the industries are those who are not in the PAT regime, of course. So they are also addressing this issue by exploring how these low hanging fruits can be availed in a very short time. What we have seen, any new technology when it comes into picture for the intervention, for the implementation or the deployment, it actually comes with a higher cost. And that gives a great challenge to us, any of the end user, whether to adopt this or not adopt this. Take the case of a very simple example, which we recently did in Surat. in a textile industry. This was under a JEP program again. JEP is the Global Environment Facility, and there are certain, you know, some program modalities where there I'm not going to discuss in all detail in that. In that particular one, we see that there was, you know, the compressed air system, which you may be knowing, about 25 to 30% of your electricity consumption probably would be going to only with the, particularly that utility, I mean, well, compressed air system. Air is free, but compressed air is not free. So you know how much, you know, even with a 1 bar reduction in the pressure in the air which you are using, that can save about 6 to 8% of your energy consumption, electrical energy consumption. At the same time, sizing of the compressor, then you know, modulation of the compressor, how you are utilizing it, leakage control, all these things again are value or add, you know, to the entire compressed air system. Those are the system part, but I'm talking about the equipment. In that particular unit, it's a small, it's MSME unit, in fact. So I just, you know, just came to my mind as to give an example to that. That particular, it was using some reciprocating compressors and so where the, you know, the specific energy consumption was somewhere more than 0.25 kilowatt per CFM or so and so forth, which is very, very high, or even 0.3 kilowatt per CFM, which is very, very high as compared to the best available practice of the technology. We try to adopt that with a, you know, with a new technology. One is the screw compressors, and coupled with permanent magnet motors based you know, drive system. So that technology was tried there, which actually gave about 22% reduction in the saving what that was obtained during the baseline period. So that is what we try to do it after doing a lot of analysis, vendors, you know, discussion, focus group discussion with the industry. We thought that let's go and have this implementation. And this implementation was carried out after doing a lot of, you know, the internal analysis, as I said, and doing the procurement. We did that. It was not a very big, you know, implementation challenge was there. But in the overall, what we could see, when we go for a, you know, before that we also did some demand aggregation approach, and we saw that the technology cost, we got about 15% reduction in the price what is available in the market, right, to that technology. I'm not going to touch upon that aspect particularly, but there is a cost reduction through our innovative procurement process. So with this, what we could see, there is a improvement in the energy efficiency or reduction in the energy consumption by almost 22% or 23%. And the payback period which obtained was roughly around, you know, 11 months, or, you know, there are two demonstrations. In one case, it is almost 1 year. The other case, it is 1 year, 1 year, 3 months or something like that. So those are the kind of things what we try to do. And once we standardize that particular technology, and we see that in that particular cluster, there is a similar, you know, application or a replication potential in various other units as well. So we got an, you know, we did an assessment, and we see that there are more than 50 industries who are actually ready to buy this type of, deploy this type of technology. Now they saw this implementation. It was a proof of concept. It was through the demonstration. They saw that it is fairly good because the technology providers are in place. The implementation has not much challenge, and the energy savings are coming. And when they saw it, they believed it. Now the point is that who will put money to this? Suppose those 50 industries will come forward and say, "Boss, we want to implement this program because it looks very attractive to us." Then who is going to invest that? That is where ESL jumped in. So we take this challenge of technology, because we are taking the risk of technology challenge, whether it is fail, then it will be actually covered under the warranty obligations and so on and so forth. And we also go for the procurement through the demand aggregation, because it is a standardized technology right now in that case. And moreover, we bring the investment to that. So that means there is no upfront investment burden to the industry. That's the value proposition we are bringing to the table. And once we invest there, definitely it cannot be free. So you have to pay me back. So that repayment would come from the monetized energy saving. That means you are saving X amount, and you pay from that X amount to us. But there is no monitoring, no measurement involved, which the typical ESCO model goes. So what we are trying to hear that, because you have seen that around 20% saving is there, so you are pretty sure that even if you take the bare minimum number, 15% saving will come. So you calculate that this is the money I would be saving per month, and out of that I will pay something to ESL to recover their investment or our investment. So in this case, what we see here, about 70% of the monetized energy saving, that is actually paid back to ESL. 30% is retained with it, because that's the analysis done through the proof of concept or through the demonstration. So that means it is a win-win situation for everyone, that without putting any upfront investment, without taking any technological risk, without taking going through the procurement processes. Typically our industries, you know, particularly in the small and medium scale enterprises, it is a great, great challenge. So ESL is bringing all those expertise to the table. This, ladies and gentlemen, we did the same exercise in a larger auto manufacturing industry 1 year back, 1.5 years back. That is in Mahindra and Mahindra. There we brought 2-3 technologies as a package. That is why we call it as integrated energy efficiency. What we did there, we actually replaced around 1.8 lakh number of industrial lights, which they were having, floor lights, or, you know, so many other related industrial lights, which you are encountering or using in your day, in your facilities. So those were replaced with LED lights, number one. Number two, we replaced about 500 numbers of their air conditioners, split air condition, with a super efficient air conditioner. I think my colleague Mr. Shukla will highlight the nitty-gritties of that program. Particularly, it's coming under a national program of super efficient air conditioner program, which is actually the best available technology in India, which we have come out with that particular product with that efficiency value is not available in the general market. So that particular technology was defined and manufactured or said to the, I mean, to, you know, it was procured from the manufacturer as a trailer made requirement of ours. And we procured about 50,000 number of super efficient air conditioners, which are about 30% more efficient than the average 4-star rated machines. And that is, again, we deployed there. That's number two. Number three, we also replaced around 1,000 number or even more than that of the old motors, which are driving their pumps or fans or blowers or anything. So those motors were replaced with IE3 motors, which are actually more efficient than a IE1 or even less substandard motors. So with the fourth technology which we brought to them is the trigeneration. The trigeneration, as the name suggests, it actually produces three different things from a single source. I think you may be knowing about this technology very much. You have to have a single source of energy, that is the natural gas. With that natural gas, you connect with a gas generator, produce the electricity from the exhaust gas, which is having a temperature in the range of 400 to 450 degrees centigrade. And depending upon the volume of the waste heat going out, that you can utilize to generate some cooling by using one vapor absorption machine. And partial of this waste heat can also go for a heating purpose. So in Mahindra and Mahindra, ladies and gentlemen, we implemented by installing 800 kilowatt of the machine, which is generating certain amount of electricity. The exact figures I have not remembered, but that is there in the place. And it is actually supplying electricity to their paint shop. It is generating cooling, and it is providing cooling of their, you know, two shops, which in any case were earlier using grid-based connections. I mean, the air conditioners which are connected to grid-based solution. At the same time, the waste heat was also going for some preheating of their materials and all these things. So that is a very win-win situation. See, the overall system efficiency, if you just see in a tri-generation system, it goes from a bare minimum 30% to even 80%. If you just singly generating one generator electricity, the efficiency level would be somewhere 27 to 30%. And when you have a co-generation system, it goes up to again 55 or 60%. But in the tri-generation system, if you just see, it touches about 80%. So in this case, but this is a new technology. It looks very simple, but while implementing, the designing, the weight balance, the material balancing, everything has its own challenge. And ESL took that responsibility. Mahindra and Mahindra Simple gave us the avenue, the area where it is to be implemented. Of course, they were a part of the entire thing. But the technological design, bringing the technology into the place and putting the money as the investment, that was completely taken care of by ESL. And we are now, some agreement were signed. It is a service level agreement where ESL will ensure that these are the minimum performance level to be ensured. And again, we have the back-to-back arrangement with the vendors or the suppliers. But Mahindra or the end user will pay back to ESL in a staggered way, maybe in the next 5 years period. The fourth one is that we also try to bring the capacity building and training program for them. So ESL in this year, its capacity building program, including energy audit. So we provided the solution in lighting. We provided the solution in air conditioner, in energy efficient motors, in tri-generation. And apart from that, we handhold their employees to understand certain technical issues or technical operational practices by improving their know-hows. So the say for an example, if I just take you, the lubricant conservation. The lubricant conservation can be one of the great energy or cost-saving area in your industry. I don't know how many of you really understand or would have done any analysis that what is the cost you are incurring towards your lubricant usage in various of your rotating equipments and so on, whether it's the grease or the oil, but what is the probability of saving in that? We have done, I personally have done a lot of lubricant conservation studies in various industries, and it is seen that about 25 to 30% energy saving could be possible. I mean, lubricant saving could be possible with some low hanging approach. I mean, without doing much investments. You can extend the life of the lubricant by certain upper technologies. We can, there is a condition monitoring of the lubricants where we can see that whether the monitoring of the, whether the, the life of the lubricant is still there when you are going to replace it or throw it out, so and so forth. So these are all science behind it. Ladies and gentlemen, these are the solutions we gave it to Mahindra and Mahindra, and we are talking into so many other industries where this integrated energy efficiency solutions as a package, we are giving it to them. And more importantly, not only the technological solution, as I am again and again saying, we bring the investment to the board. So please consider it as a win-win situation, and probably we can, we can join hands together to invite you to be a part of this national movement of the energy efficiency. Now, the point here is that how we will go forward to this. So I think we have already developed the programs. We have already the procurement things are in place. That means that the cost discovery and the price discovery of various technologies have already been there. What we need that if you are interested to venture into this kind of engagement with ESL, you may directly write to us. We can have a quick studies of your plans and see that what could be possible. But we have, let me be very frank and candid from my point, we have not yet touched upon the more complex process-related interventions. ESL has not done that. Say for an example, probably we can go up to the next stage. That is, say for an example, a replacement of your older pumps with the new pumps. That can be. So it's a pump level study can be done. Or waste heat recovery project. That can be doable. But if you think that something can be done by changing the process of the things, probably ESL would not be the right in a right position to address at this stage. That is our thought process going forward. And you must have seen how ESL has been successful in various other interventions, particularly the LED lighting program in the country, the domestic lighting program, as well as the street lighting program, which has been very, very successful. We had some innovative model. We didn't seek any kind of subsidy or incentive from the government. It was completely a market-driven approach. And we see that how the price of the lights have come down almost 1/8 of the time in a span of about 2.5 years. So this similar approach we want to try in the in the industrial sectors as well. I'll call on conclude because I'm either running time and I'm eating the other speakers time space. We have, if I just give you a very small example to that, we simply intervened with 7 public sector undertaking in last 2 to 3 years, and we provided them the solution only in lighting. NTPC, for an example, we provided the solution in their 24 plants. Do you know how much was the investment from the last 3 years? It is 340 crores. 340 crores amount of, I mean, that's the kind of investment we have done. And these are not on the staggered payment way. These are all upfront payments. So what we do, we aggregate the demand from them, do the procurement. Once we do the procurement, we get a very, very less price. Because you may ask question, why NTPC is coming to ESL, why they are not directly purchasing from the client, from the vendor? So actually they were doing this, but they were not getting the price advantage, number one. Number two, entire procurement process they have to run. Now we are running, for which we may charge some project management consultancy fees. And there are certain other organizations who says, boss, I don't have money in my pocket, I cannot do you, give you the upfront payment. Then we thought, okay, we have the plan B. Then let's put, this is called as an energy servicing company model, or we call it as a ESCO model. So that means we do the entire thing. We define the problem statement, we do the diagnostic study, we fix the technical specification, we do the procurement process, we put the money, I mean the bring the investment, and help you in the implementation as and when required. In that process, you pay me back my entire cost in a period of 4 years or 5 years period. And if you do this analysis on your table or your paper, you will see that how attractive this model is. And in this process, what we say, the overall project cost will be having then 2 components in the plan B, what I said a little bit earlier. So this will be the material cost, and there will be a project management cost. Material cost is discovered through open bidding process. It is a transparent mechanism. Then there will be a 10 to 12% project management cost of ESL because of the works we are doing or supporting to you. And the third one would be, there will be a cost of financing. Because our investment comes with 20% equity and 80% debt. So there is a return on equity as defined by our board. And there is an interest to our debt component, which is again as per the market prevailing rate. So those things can be actually, we can discuss across the table for mutual beneficial, to come out with a mutual beneficial number. But those are the things, these are the broad models which we are utilizing. So I am just reaching out to with a humble suggestion that why only Mahindra? Why cannot be 100 Mahindras in our country? And if this model has been successful, if these things are in place, I request you, please come forward, join in this movement, and be a part of country's commitment to our national international community, that we will be reducing 30 to 35% our CO2 emission level by 2030. Thank you very much for joining this call, and look forward to have a very, very fruitful association with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. That was highly informative and interesting, especially to know about the Mahindra case study and the real examples which ESL has implemented on ground. Thank you so much. Now I would like to invite Dr. Anand Shukla to speak about ESL's super efficient AC program. At present, Dr. Anand Shukla is working with ESL as the additional general manager, and he leads many flagship programs such as Super Efficient AC, District Energy Systems in the cities, and also supports GEF activities and programs. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Sumedha. Thank you very much, Garnaik sir, for your speech. I think you have covered most of the points which I would have covered in my presentation. So I will keep my presentation short, and I will focus more on the question and answers at the end of the session. So yeah, please allow me to present on the super efficient air conditioner program. Sumedha, I see some
Anand, hello.
Your screen is visible to me. I cannot see my presentation completely. Hello.
And then the tab, yeah, the tab bar is visible. Now we can see. Now it's fine.
Okay, now it's better. Thanks a lot. So basically, I will talk about super efficient air conditioner program. As Garnaik sir has already mentioned that we have, you know, we have launched several flagship programs, and super efficient air conditioner program is one of them. And we have launched this program in July 2019, and the initial focus was on retail customers, and thereby we have launched a website in 2019, and the retail customers can order the air conditioner online, and then these ACs are, you know, used to be delivered. We also have developed this website to raise the awareness of the end customer, and this program has been running successfully until now. And I will present a brief overview on the program and how we have developed and what is our way forward with regard to super efficient air conditioner program. So in my, I cannot change the slides. Oh, okay, yeah, now. So I will briefly present on the global and national scenario. Then I will briefly talk about the standard and labeling program. I understand that you all would know about it, but I will still like to mention like why the five star and the best in five star is important in present context. That will also correlate with the national scenario and the commitments the government of India has to the international community. And then I will come down very briefly on the super efficient air conditioner program. So basically, as you know, that India, the per capita space cooling energy consumption, when we talk about energy consumption, that is in terms of kilowatt hour per person, per annum, is among the lowest among its peers. So for example, if you see that the United States of America, the kilowatt hour consumption per person is around 2000 kilowatt hours per year. For Japan, it is roughly around 1000. And if you see India, it is very low. That is 69 kilowatt hour per person per year. And it's even less than Indonesia, which has a very limited metro cities and very limited, you know, populated cities as compared to India. So definitely this 69 kilowatt hour per person per year annum will set to grow, because India is seeing a rapid increase in built up area. Lot of companies are coming up, lot of factories are being built, lot of the built up area is being built. The purchasing power of Indians are increasing, and the purchasing power of middle class income, which used to you know, use the air desert coolers, would slowly shift to the air conditioner. Now, so the use of air conditioner very much relates to the annual cooling degree days. These cooling degree days are those days when you need the air conditioners. I am sure you must have also observed that the number of days when we need an air conditioning inside our house, inside the cars, and wherever we are in malls, shopping complexes, has increased a lot during the past few years. And this is set to grow because because of global warming, and the more and more things we consume, it will lead to urban heat island effect, and you know, all this comes together. So the air conditioning will be an important factor in the overall power consumption. So as of now, if you see that the total number of air conditioners is around 1.2 billion globally, and this is set to grow by roughly around 4 to 5 times in 2050. So definitely we are not prepared to the total primary energy supply will not be sufficient when we talk about the fossil fuel, and even renewable energy will not be able to meet these kind of exponential growth in coming years. And not only this will put a challenge on the energy requirement, the total primary energy, but also this will put a burden on the environment. And the emissions by 2050 will grow only because of you know, unitary air conditioner I'm talking about will grow up to 20 gigatons CO2 emissions by 2050. So definitely there is a need to develop a program and also to move from non-energy efficient or low efficient products to higher energy efficient products. And not only higher, but also the best efficiency in those higher energy efficiency. That is the reason we have called this program a super efficient, energy efficient air conditioner program, because we are not talking about the five star, but also the best in the five star air conditioners available in the market. So, and also the emissions, the increase in the cooling demand will also include lot of, you know, investments. So if we improve, if we use less and produce more, then the investment will also be addressed accordingly. So last year in March, the India Cooling Action Plan was launched, and I have taken three objectives from this India Cooling Action Plan, which directly and correlates to the super efficient AC program. So the India Cooling Action Plan talks about the reduction in cooling demand by 20 to 25% in the next 2 decades. So you see, by 2038, the cooling demand has to needs to be reduced up to 25%. And you know, then you would ask me a question like how you would reduce the cooling demand. So there are various ways, you know, the way of the way buildings are being constructing, the use of glass, use of insulation, and you know, reflective coating and all. There are several things like the double glazed windows. So adopting to these kind of technologies will reduce the cooling demand, and we have to work in that direction. As you know, that most of the buildings in India are not insulated, it's only concrete, and no buildings or very less buildings use hollow bricks and all. So these things, this technology needs to be implemented on a war footing scale. So the next objective which I have taken is you know, reduction in refrigerant demand. So you know, the you know about the Montreal Protocol, Kyoto Protocol, the Kigali Agreement, and all these talks about limiting or phasing out certain kind of refrigerants. So this program, the AC program, also is focusing on use of greener refrigerant, and we have used a refrigerant which has GWP, that is global warming potential, of less than 700. And it has zero ozone depleting potential, and it has no ozone depleting substance used in the air conditioner. So the India Cooling Action Plan also talks about the training and certification. So most of the time it happens that, you know, you have an air conditioner or air conditioning system in, at your office, home, or in premises. And the, whenever the technician comes to repair and maintain your air conditioner, they just release the gas, and this gas is released to the environment, and it you know, it contributes to the depletion of ozone layer. And also the, if the services are not done properly, if the charging of the gas is not done properly, this also impacts the performance of the AC. And even if however good the efficiency of the air conditioner is, if it is not maintained, serviced properly, that can ultimately result to more energy consumption, and hence bringing down the energy efficiency, and will impact your pocket. So definitely there is a need to train and certify service sector professionals. So the target of under India Cooling Action Plan is to train 100,000 such technicians in the coming 4 to 5 years. So with this India Cooling Action Plan, I would also like to mention that last year in November 2019, we have launched a vision document. And this vision document very nicely presents the overall scenario of the air conditioning market in India. So if you see, if you read this document, you will realize that as of now, all over the country, around 8 million units of ACs are sold. And this number will grow by 4.5 times, or just to make it simple, it will grow by 5 times. So by 2038, that is in sync with the India Cooling Action Plan, the number of ACs in India will be 40 million units. So this will have a big impact on the total primary energy supply that is needed to provide energy to the air conditioners. And here I'm only talking about air conditioner, but you can also think about various other technologies that will also grow in the years to come. So there is a need to focus on energy efficiency. Whatever be the system, energy efficiency comes first. So coming back to the air conditioning program, so So I was talking about 8 million ACs sold in India as of now per annum. And out of these 8 million ACs sold, 60% of these ACs are three-star. And only very limited number, roughly between 10 to 15% of the ACs sold in India are four-star or five-star. So definitely there is a need to shift this three-star, two-star or very less number of one-star to five-star and the best in five-star air conditioners. And that is what this program focuses on. So as of now, the AC penetration in India is 6%. And with the growing demand up to 5% in the next two decades, the AC program, which we have launched last year, plays an important role. So this report was launched in Inspire 2019. That is an annual event organized by EESL. And you can also have a look on this report. This is our report is available on our website, and you will get a lot of insights. But for the sake of this presentation, I have taken two slides from the report, and that also presents what I have just deliberated. So basically, as I mentioned, that the cooling, the demand for space cooling will increase. You can see from this graph, and it shows like how the cooling demand will grow. So you see like in another 6 to 7 years, there will be a sharp increase in the cooling demand. And then definitely we have to be prepared for this sharp increase in cooling demand, and we have to take action now. So this again also talks about the total primary energy supply or the energy used by various type of cooling or refrigeration equipments. And this talks about cold chains and refrigeration, coolers, fans, package direct expansion, chillers, and room air conditioners, among others. So this is a graph which will definitely see a growth, and an action has to be taken well in time. So as I mentioned, that I will briefly talk about the STAR labeling standards and labeling program. So whatever air conditioners you have brought, you have bought 3 years back. Let's say you have bought three-star AC 3 years back. Is no more three-star. It is either two-star if it is maintained properly. Otherwise, the performance of that AC practically is less than two-star or maybe one-star. So there is a good reason to change that air conditioner with the most efficient air conditioner. And that is what I want to present from this slide, that until 2018, we have been calling this energy efficient. We have been measuring the performance of ACs in terms of energy efficiency ratio. However, beginning 2018, the seasonal factor has also come into the performance of the ACs, and the technology has also been upgraded. Previously, the compressor used was non-inverter, and now the compressor is inverter. The difference between inverter and non-inverter is very simple. Just for the simplicity, the non-inverter AC, the compressor switches on and off. It is like a switch. But in the case of inverter AC, it does not switch off and on, but it ramps up and ramps down the RPM of the compressor. And there are various advantages of this technology. The biggest advantage when you see the indoor temperature is that the ramping up and ramping down of the compressor is able to meet the constant temperature demand. अदरवाइज पहले क्या होता था 24 डिग्री हो गया जब तक वो 25 या 26 नहीं जाएगा तब तक वो कंप्रेसर स्टार्ट नहीं होता था सो योर विंडो वाज द डेल्टा टी वाज लेट्स से 3 टू 4 डिग्रीज बट इन द केस ऑफ दिस एसी इट विल ट्राई इट बेस्ट टू मेंटेन द टेंपरेचर लेट्स से एट 24 डिग्री और 28 और व्हाटएवर टेंपरेचर यू सेट इनसाइड सो दैट इज द एडवांटेज ऑफ दिस टेक्नोलॉजी एंड एज यू नो गर्नाक सर हैज ऑलरेडी मेंशन दैट ऑल द स्कीम्स which we have launched in the past and are launching in present and future, those schemes are without subsidy, and we are not taking any incentive from any external agency, and we are passing on the incentive in fact to the retail or the institutional clients. What is the business model? The business model is, as sir has already mentioned, that we aggregate the demand, and whatever the benefits we incur because of this demand aggregation, we share it with our stakeholders, the clients, and the partners. and we make use of large procurements where we make use of economies of scale and thereby bring down the price, as we have done successfully in several programs in the past. The best example I quote often is Ujala. And we take the risk and the challenges when it comes to procurement, installation, when it comes to servicing and maintenance. And but the client only takes the most advantages, that is in terms of shared benefits, in terms of cost, as well as in terms of best performing equipment. So this program we have launched, the program partners are United Nations Environment, Asian Development Bank, and under Global Environment Facility, ESL is of course the implementing agency, and we have done an international tendering, and Voltas has won that international tendering and is the original equipment manufacturer of this existing phase of this program. So now let me go a little detail into the AC program. So as I mentioned earlier, that this air conditioner, which we have launched in July 2019, is not only 5-star. This is something which is beyond 5-star. So the BE rating mentions that any AC which is rated which has an Indian seasonal energy efficiency ratio of 4.5 will be rated at 5-star, where there is no upper limit. So most of the products which you see on e-retail shops or in the market, those will be 4.5 star ACs mostly, but very few product will be above 4.5. So that is the target which we have taken, and that is a challenge we have taken, and have launched an AC which is much higher in terms of performance, and the ISER ratio, ISER value is 5.4 as compared to 4.5. So there is a huge saving when we compare it with 3-star, 4-star, and also a substantial saving when we compare it with 4.5 star AC. But there is also several advantages which I will also explain. And the higher efficiency of this product is because of definitely the components and the way the AC works, and the software part of this AC which controls the compressor also plays an important role. So last year we launched this website, and you see the launch price of this AC was 41,300, and I have deliberately used this slide here because that time the price or the cost of other ACs of the same ISER value was around 65,000 rupees per AC or even higher. So we have launched this program at a very, you know, at almost, let's say, 2/3 of the cost. And we have also made this product available on the website. But here also it is important that the price has been further reduced to 39,990. So if you go and buy it on the website or place an order to us, there is further, a reduction in price around 1,310 rupees. So this has become further competitive. Not only this, we have also increased the, previously the warranty on the product was 1 year and on compressor was 5 years, but recently we have revised the warranty. So now the warranty is 5 years on the whole product and 10 years on the compressor. And also the installation cost has been brought down from 1400 rupees previously to 599 today. So whenever it comes to retail customers or any customer which is in a transition phase and want to take a decision whether they would like to go for 3-star, 4-star or 5-star, and we have also provided an energy saving calculator on the website, so they can slide. So just to make it simple, they can choose that whether they are going to buy a replacement AC or a new one, which will be their first AC in their the house or office complex, and they can choose if the existing AC is window or split, and then they can select the star rating if they're considering a replacement, and also what is the electricity tariff in terms of rupees per kilowatt hour, and then this small calculator will give an estimated savings So this is how we have also sensitized customers through our web portal. And so most of the customers, when we approach them, as Garnaik sir has mentioned, that there will be a saving of 35%. So most of the participants in this discussion would raise questions like, have you checked it? What is the basis of 35%? Have you demonstrated it somewhere? So yes, we have done our studies, and I have shown a chart, and this chart, the graph is a real-time data which we have collected from one of the pilot sites in Mumbai. And this is one of the ATMs which we have considered, because at that time we were talking to one of the leading banks, and the bank has said, like, you replace our the existing AC with a 5-star AC. So in this graph, if you see, we have replaced an existing AC with a 5.2 ISER. And here in this, the focus of this presentation is ISER 5.4, which is even better than the AC which is considered in this chart. So if you see this chart, then the curve on the left hand side has come down drastically in the greenish highlighted area, and this drop is around 31.6%. So definitely there is a reduction in energy demand in an ATM, and this demand reduction is around 31.6% per day. And if you see the curve, we have monitored this for 10 days, and none of the never this graph went beyond 13.5 kilowatt hour per day, and previously it was always above 18 kilowatt. So there is a substantial amount of energy saving. And cost savings, I have not mentioned cost savings, because cost savings can be translated based on the hours of operation and the tariff you are paying at your premises. So that can be calculated, and it's a simple calculation. Now, whenever it comes to a product, the most important factor is how to place an order and how your queries and complaints are addressed. So I also would like to mention that we have a process flow. So for a retail customer, they can go to the website, they can fill in their detail, they can make the payment, and as soon as the order is confirmed, the delivery of the products is arranged by Voltas, and the delivery in metro cities, tier one cities, is 3 days delivery period, and in tier two cities, it is 7 days. However, I would also mention that during the past few months, we were not able to fulfill this delivery period because of lockdown logistical challenges, and now the things have all are returning to normalcy, so we are again back on track. And after the product is installed, and also after supply, we have two dedicated toll-free numbers, and if you want to know about the schemes, there is a dedicated number, and if you want to know about the product, you can talk on the phone, or also feel free to write us on email. And when it comes to offline customers, so most of the orders which we receive from offline customers are, they place an order to us manually, and then we ensure that, so we as ESL act as single point of contact for them, and we ensure that all the terms and conditions which we agreed with the clients are delivered, and we also ensure that the service, the comprehensive AMCs are addressed within the turnaround time, which is the industry standards. So that is all I would like to present today, and in case there are any questions, I would be happy to answer. Back to you, Subedha and Anand.
Thank you, Dr. Anand, for explaining the super efficient AC program and how important it is to switch to this highly efficient AC. Now, moving on, I would now like to invite my last speaker for today's webinar, Mr. Abhishek, who will be speaking about ESL's National Motor Replacement Program. Mr. Abhishek has been working closely with ESL for National Motor Replacement Program since its inception in developing the program framework by providing technical assistance and conducting market outreach activities. Currently, he's at International Copper Association India. He's heading Motors and Motor Driven Program, responsible for promoting energy efficient motors and pumps pan India. Over to you, sir.
Thanks, Sumedha. Is my screen visible now?
Yes, it's visible.
Thank you. So, yes, so I welcome each of the participants present today who have taken out time to listen about how the programs can help them improve the overall efficiency of their systems in their plants. So we'll focus today on motors through under the NMRP program. So let me tell you a brief about International Copper Association. So we are a knowledge-based organization which have expertise basically to implement market transformation projects along with the supporting partners in the field of energy efficiency. We also promote sustainable use of copper through, in the different fields, which you can clearly see here in the energy supply chain with the manufacturers, policymakers, energy advocates, and users. The current ongoing programs of ICA are basically in the field of distribution transformers, higher efficiency motors, air conditioners, wire and cable, and power quality. Coming on to why to focus on motors. So as we are aware that motors are basically the prime movers in any industry, be it a micro, small, medium, or large kind of a plant. So motors are installed everywhere. And clearly the share of motor is very high. Hence, there is a need to focus on how you can improve the efficiency of motor, which will in turn help you in improving the system efficiency also. So taking the note of this, the Department of Industrial Policy and Promotion under Ministry of Commerce has basically brought out a quality control order in 2018, which has banned IE1 motors in India. So when we talk about energy efficient motors, IE2 is now the minimum energy performance standard. And hence any motor available in the market, either domestically produced or imported, will be minimum I2, and hence you can only buy I2 and above motors. Taking the note of this, ESL has taken a initiative in rolling out a national motor replacement program to help industries basically adopt energy efficient, or let's say the primary efficiency I3 motors, as you can see in the infographic, that I3 is basically a step above I2, which is currently the minimum energy performance standard. So this voluntary program aims to address the cost barrier which the industry faces while purchasing I3 motors. Also, it aims to address any kind of financial barrier faced by SME industries or any industry who would like to basically procure this technology with the help of financial support. That is also done. And this program also complements the Perform Achieve Trade scheme of Bureau of Energy Efficiency, where the energy intensive industries are targeted to improve their or let's say reduce their energy consumption. Now, just a brief idea how how the improvement in energy efficiency is there when you move from an IE1 or below IE1 motor to IE3 motor. So if you see in the small, medium, and large ranges, which I have highlighted for convenience, there is a good amount of jump in the energy efficiency values. At the same time, there are reduction in losses. So that you all know that by improving the design of motor and the other components, you can basically reduce the losses, and hence your efficiency goes up. So this is just a gist of it. Now, coming on to the a motor driven system, as you all see, that motor is an integral part of the system in an industry which will be running any kind of a mechanical equipment or any equipment which will basically drive the application. So you see, by improving the electric motor, there are chances that your system improvement will be there. But it should also be taken care that having an holistic approach of improving the other system parameters or other equipments will give a tremendous improvement in your system efficiency. So I'll just explain it through an illustrative example here. You have a old motor, which is, let's say, running a fan and is either coupled through a belt pulley system or through a gearbox or directly coupled, whatever that scenario may be. And when you replace that same old 22 kilowatt motor with an i3 motor, you basically improve the efficiency. But we need to also take care of the system efficiency. I mean the driven equipment efficiency. If we can improve that also, you can see there will be a good amount of jump, and hence how an i3 motor will be able to give you a tremendous amount of savings in terms of energy as well as cost. So this is one way of looking at it, and the other is through what we have done through the deemed savings approach and validated through our pilot studies. So ESL could conduct a pilot study of number of i3 motors in different sectors. So it varied from chemical cluster, brass cluster, textile cluster, and an automotive giant. So clearly you can see the savings were to the tune of 10 to 16%. And these pilots were conducted through various expert agencies, energy auditing agencies, and they did a detailed report, carried out a baseline consumption, and then installed the new i3 motor and came out with the energy savings. So these were done for the centrifugal loads, or may I say variable torque loads, where we could see the benefit those plants where the pilot was done was achieved. So this was done by ESL before rolling out the program, so that it could be established that there is a savings by improving your motor efficiency. Now coming on to the genesis of NMRP. So NMRP program, the administrator here is EESL. EESL basically, with their ongoing relationship with the industries and commercial establishments, also through outreach agencies, or let's say the demand aggregators, try to assess the need of customer of how they can improve the how they can adopt the i3 motors. And then there is a open tendering process done by ESL. It is a very competitive and transparent method of basically doing the bulk procurement. The benefit of such kind of a procurement mechanism is that we get a reduced cost of the equipment. Also, we can inbuild the features which are suitable for the customers, which they demand in future, that can be inbuilt in their technical specification. Also, we can have a project duration of, depending upon the customer need, it can vary from 1 year to 3 years. One of the other feature of ESL procurement as well as the program is that it has various payment options. So a customer can, as Garnaji rightly told at the start of the program, that there should be no burden on the customer nowadays to procure any energy efficient technology. So that taking care of that, this feature has also been inbuilt in this National Motor Replacement Program. And the entire program is managed through an online dedicated web portal, which I'll be telling you in the later slides, and the participants can take note of it and maybe visit that to have a better understanding. Now coming to the operating model, as I've told earlier, that ESL acts as a program administrator. So basically, once the tender is rolled out and the prices are discovered, ESL purchases the motor from the manufacturers, and as per the need of the client industries, be it MSME or large corporates, the motors are basically supplied to them, and the repayment is done under various payment models. And the warranty obligation is also being taken care of by ESL through a back-to-back arrangement with the manufacturers, where you can have you can enjoy the benefit of having an extended warranty over and above what is there in the market. So the participants present today from the technical background will be interested in knowing this, that ultimately which is the product covered under ESL and NMRP program. So we are covering the range of three-phase squirrel cage induction motors, and basically these are the LT motors, not HT. These are ranging from 0.75 kilowatt to 75 kilowatt, and all these motors are taken care of that they produce a performance value of I3 as per IS/IC standards. So these motors will give you basically an efficiency as per their franchise with respect to IS and IC. So none of the customers have to have an issue with that. Also, the pole and mounting covered are basically the most installed in the industry. So these are 2, 4, 6 pole, 4, 10 flange. While we coming to the prominent features, the all the motors covered under NMRP are basically VFD compatible, and they taking care of the bearing arrangement on the ND side for higher motors. We have also provided insulated bearing for the motors which will be used with VFDs, and all these motors are suitable for your variable torque applications like pumps, compressors, blowers, fans, etc. Now coming on to why NMRP, or what are the features of NMRP that industry should opt for NMRP. So as you see in market, there is a certain retail price when you go or purchase it through a dealer or any intermediary, and you are offered I2, I3 motors. ESL has gone a notch above and is offering I3 motors at a reduced cost. That is basically through the demand aggregation, which ESL is doing at an India level, and this will help a customer address the upfront cost barrier of purchasing a new I3 motor. So that is taken care under this program. Also, there is a benefit of double warranty period. So in market, in the conventional model, you get a 1 year or a 1.5 year warranty, while under the NMRP program, you get a 3 year warranty. One of the best feature of this program is that you don't have to pay upfront. If you want, you can take help of ESL, and the entire investment shall be done by ESL on your behalf. And all these motors, let me tell you, before being supplied to industries, go through a pre-dispatch inspection, and all these motors are basically inspected at the manufacturer's plant. In case any issue, the motors are rejected, and the fresh lot of motors are basically supplied to the customer. So this is a quality check which is being done by ESL rigorously, and there is no escape to that. Also, if required for bulk orders, ESL can help you in doing a walkthrough audit and help you in getting the savings from I3 motors. Also, for the customers, there is a feature that any kind of a technical training required on motors in terms of operation and maintenance, or the technical terms of how benefit they can get from using an I3 motors are also done. Coming on to the explanation of the ESL business models. So there are two models. Basically, one is a PMC model, which is known as a project management consultancy model. Here the scope is strictly to the supply of the motor, and the entire investment, the bearing of the cost, capital cost of the motor is done by the client. ESL helps you with the inventory collection, procurement facilitation, providing the extended warranty, and overall monitoring the project in case of any issues are there. That is being done by ESL. And there is another model, which is ESCO model, which is also known as that the financial model. And here the entire upfront investment is done by EESL. Under this scheme, apart from the routine work which is done in PMC model, ESL also takes care that the financial burden on customer is taken care of, and in return the customer is only have to provide a bank guarantee to safeguard ESS payment. There is no sort of hassle of submitting any paperwork or getting any credit rating approved by any agency or something of that sort. So it is a simple giving a bank guarantee, and from the day one the motors are yours, and you can repay it in quarterly installments in a period of 1 to 3 years as the case may be. And mind you, this is also known as a shared saving approach. Why? Because while the customer has received all the motors on day one and started installing and enjoying the energy savings, but the payment is made out of those savings in a period of 3 years. So that analysis is being done by ESL at their end when you submit your inventory, and the proposal is submitted to you in such a manner that there is a shared saving. In case it does not come out, then this model is not being provided by ESL to that customer. In most of the cases, it comes out. Only in cases where the operating hours are very low or something of that sort happens, there ESL advises customer not to go for it. Coming on to a typical case situation, if we consider, let's say, a case of 25 motors of various ratings provided by the industry. See, so the calculation is done by ESL on the deemed savings approach, and we basically take I1 as the baseline. Why I1? Because till 2011, the motors offered or used by the industries were basically I1 or below. So we have safely taken I1 as a baseline. So this is well known by the industries that motors currently installed are either 10 years, 15 years, 20 years old. And we have received so many inquiries, we have executed so many orders where the motors were even as old as 25 years, 30 years. So it is a high time to replace them. And taking I1 as the baseline, it is a conservative approach so that the customer does not complain in future that I could not get the savings which you have claimed. So that is the way ESL approaches to give the benefit to customer. And based on your annual operating hours, the consumption is made based on your loading. The things are reviewed and a proposal is submitted to the industry. Now, in that proposal, when you compare the PMC and ESCO model, you have a benefit that in ESCO, you pay over a period of time, and hence your the cost, the capital cost or the project cost gets divided into various quarters. And this is an illustration of a case situation, how you can repay it over a period of time. So basically, ESL just takes a PMC piece on the cost of motors, which is discovered in the tender. Mind you, there is no additional charge levied on the capital cost of motor in terms of the price of motor. So this price of motor as discovered in the tender is being offered to the customer. Only a admin charge or let's say a PMC fee is being taken by ESL, and which will be including your transportation, insurance, and other benefits like pre-dispatch inspection. So all that is covered under this. Nothing extra has to be paid. Even customers can go and inspect the motors if they want at the manufacturer's premise. So this is how this moves. I'll explain you through a pictorial representation which will make it more clear. So here you see, this is a PMC model, which is strictly a supply contract model where the investment is done by the industry itself, and ESL provides the overall project monitoring and the warranty and the procurement facilitation, etc. So here it is a one-time repayment. Whenever the motors are delivered to the customers, within a month, they have to repay the entire amount to ESL, and they can enjoy the benefits from day one. And there is no botheration afterwards. But in case a customer feels that currently I am having a liquidity crunch, or as the situation today is due to COVID, many corporates also are approaching ESL nowadays that if we can go for ESCO mode, kindly share with us how to enroll under this program. So coming on to the ESCO model, where you repay in basically 3 years, and there is no upfront investment in my industry, so that burden is shared. I'll just explain you. When you see, there is a baseline consumption of 18 lakhs kilowatt, and the consumption which you get by using i3 motors is, let's say, reduced, which is 17 lakhs 88 thousand. This saving which you get from this is basically broken into two parts, A and B. Is, again, as I told you before, it is analyzed or worked by ESL in such a manner that it becomes a shared saving approach, and the customer retains a saving of somewhere between 25 to 35%, depending upon the parameters which they are using the motors. And the repayment to ESL is done as shown in A part, which is done in each quarter. So for next 12 quarters in a period of 3 years, you pay ESL around 3,49,000. So this is around 72% of your savings, while the 28% of the savings are retained by the customer. And the project cost here is basically, again, the price discovered under the tender, which is your material cost, plus the PMC fees charged by ESL. And there is a financial component included, because this is done in a manner that it has a return on equity as well as debt part. And this is basically at par with the market. In case customer feels that they have a better financial option with them, or they have a lower cost of finance with them, they can obviously go for a PMC model. So this is how the investment by the industry is taken care by ESL. And this is, I'd like to present a case study of Escomode with one of the customer who had a year back taken around 125 numbers of motors. And you can see the motors were varying from the range of 3.7 kilowatt to 22 kilowatt. Here, the entire investment was done by ESL, from the procurement facilitation till the delivery of the motors. And you see, the customer has shared this case study with us, and I'll just show you. They have even monitored the hourly energy consumption in case of old motors as well as i3 motors. And you can see the amount of benefit that the customer has got. Here, what they told us, that the share of cost savings was 81%. So 81% of the saving they used to repay every quarter to ESL, while around 19% was with them. And you can see the payback period. Though payback period I've mentioned here as a simple payback period is not that simple, but again, it comes to around 2 years 5 months. So this is what you can see is not a very high payback period. While when you come to a PMC mode, it will obviously be lower, but at the same time, anything below 3 years is lucrative for industries, which the feedback I get from industries. And hence, you can easily get approval for this and opt for this model to replace energy efficient motors in your plants. So this is one more case study, but it is of PMC mode, and it was for a paper sector customer. And they have only taken two ratings of 50 numbers, and they could achieve the payback in 11 months. And they also achieved a tremendous amount of savings, as you can see. So it is open to the industry in what mode they would like to replace their motors. And each mode has its own benefit. So now coming on to basically the web portal which we talk about. So this is a dedicated web portal for NMRP. Here you have features like logging in, entering your inventory, and while entering the inventory, you can even see what kind of energy savings you will get. So even if you would like to change some of the ratings, you can do it then and there. Also, you have some case studies, you have details about the program, you have an energy saving calculator, and there are certain FAQs which will address your queries. Even if that does not happen, the ESL project management unit is there for you. You can share a mail or call us, and we'll be able to help you. Coming on to how to basically go for this program, enroll in this program, is once you are ready to go with this, so you need to share your inventory. That can be done through the portal. Otherwise, we can also provide you an inventory format where you can fill in the basic nameplate details and the details like your working hours, your loading percentage, and the tariff rate. Now, once that is done, ESL submits you their proposal within 2-3 days. And this proposal is once okayed by you, whether you want to go with ESCO mode or PMC mode, then the ESL can move on for the further step as a either agreement signing under the ESCO mode or directly a purchase order for the PMC mode. And once that is done, the lead time for delivering the motor is around 45 days. Within 45 days, the motors will come to your plant. So it will be directly shipped from the manufacturer's plant to your site anywhere in India. And then depending upon the mode which you have signed for, your repayment will start. And all this will be monitored by ESL in case of any issue. PMU, ESL PMU is there to help you out. And yeah, that is all. These are the few major customers which we have served in past 1 or 2 years. And all have been satisfied. Even few of them have even shown their case studies in CII Energy Circle competition. So we can proudly say that we are able to help industries in improving their energy efficiency or reducing the energy consumption. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Abhishek, for sharing and explaining the motor program in detail and about the unique features of NMRP and also in detail the business models. Now moving on, we will take up some of the questions which have come up, and the first one is for you only, Mr. Abhishek. Who are the eligible entities under the National Motor Program?
Eligible entities, as I mentioned, any kind of industry can participate, be it MSME or large. There is no difference for ESL. It is just that there are certain benefits for MSME and certain benefits for large. So that can be discussed once the inventory is shared by the customer to EESL.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
One more point, it is strictly for end users only, so not for any kind of intermediary or OEMs. It is strictly for end users who will install or replace motor at their plants.
Okay. The next one is for Dr. Anand. Dr. Anand, can you hear me?
Yes, Sumita.
Yeah, so the question for you is the ESCO model implementation available for the AC program, and what is the minimum project size for being eligible for this program?
So yes, the first question is yes, we have ESCO model available for the AC program. There is no such minimum requirement as of now, but I think for the sake of, you know, ESCO model, we expect that at least 100 to 200 ACs are ordered, because otherwise, you know, that can be, it will be difficult.
Okay.
So for example, the project which we are doing with Mahindra and Mahindra, we are talking about 400, 500 or 1000 ACs. So this is something which I assume that at least 100 ACs, when it's ordered, it makes economic sense for us as well as to the SME.
Thank you. And there's another question for you. What is the model for installation and commissioning? Is it done by ESL? And this is for both the AC and the motor program.
So for AC program, the model is like, there are two different ways. So for retail customer, they order, as I mentioned, they order the AC on website. And as soon as we receive the order, we pass it on the information to Voltas. And thereafter, it is taken care by Voltas. So they will supply and they will install. And in case there are some complaints regarding the supply installation, that is taken care by ESL and Voltas jointly. Whereas in the case of institutional, commercial, or bulk orders, we take care of all, we monitor the project progress. However, the on-ground implementation is still in the scope of Voltas, and warranties and all the, you know, comprehensive AMCs are fulfilled by Voltas.
Okay. Another one is for the motor program now. The size of motor present and offered by ESL may be different. Is the cost inclusive of both civil work during installation, or is it just the cost of the motor?
This includes the
Abhishek,
cost.
Abhishek, sorry to intervene you. You can also answer the previous question. A part of was directed for motor program. You can also answer that question.
Minimum order quantity, you mean to say?
No, the supply and installation part, whose scope?
Yeah. So that will come under civil. So basically, this program, the motors which are delivered and the cost of these motors will include only the material cost, the transportation cost. That is it. And there is no civil work or the installation cost added in this. What we have seen the industry practices or the business as usual is that replacing a motor requires shutdown in many of the cases. So because that cannot be dependent upon ESL's availability, so it is better for customers that they take the motor and install whenever it is feasible for them to take a shutdown. Hence, ESL does not want to intervene in that, and neither the customers ask us for doing the installation work. So that is it.
Another one for you, Mr. Abhishek. Who would sign the saving certificate with industries? Will it be ESL or ICA?
There is no asset saving certificate, but of course the entire thing is governed by EESL itself. So the proposal submission and also anything with respect to the shared saving approach, the agreement, etc., will be done by ESL. And if required, maybe Mr. Garnaik, if he's there, he can, sir, if you can elaborate more on the mechanism.
I think Mr. Garnaik has already left.
Okay, fine. So this is it. I mean, the ESL will be the body with which the customers have to interact. ICA plays as a role to promote the NMRP to the industries.
Okay. Also a question to both of you, Dr. Anant and Mr. Abhishek. How would savings be monitored in both the programs?
So at the AC program, as I already have mentioned, that we have conducted some pilot projects, and on the basis of those pilot projects and the theoretical savings. Because it is very difficult, you must understand that it is very difficult and challenging to monitor the real-time savings, because the operating conditions for an air conditioner varies, and the operating hours, for example, the variables could be operating hours, the temperature you set, the humidity, the weather conditions. So there are several factors which impact the savings. So it is very challenging to, convey any concrete number when it comes to saving. So, it cannot be correlated directly or simply with the monetary savings. So, that is the reason we are, going on with this program on upfront basis, and it is not, we are not recommending this, to more on linked savings when it comes to ESCO, because the savings are, varies a lot.
Okay.
Complementing to what Anant ji has said for motors also, basically the program is developed on a deemed savings approach, and by this what we mean is that the proposal which we share with you can see the amount of savings in that. Now I agree that because all these system parameters operating for each rating of each motor will vary. Hence the energy efficiency, hence the energy savings will also vary from each rating to each motor. So it will be difficult to monitor it. What industry can do is, once if you place your order or sign an agreement with ESL, and this is especially in the case for bulk procurement. So we are looking at somewhere around 100 motors. There we can conduct a sample energy audit for let's say 10% of the motors, and this can help you establish that. But for motors less than 100, it is advisable that you go on deemed savings approach, savings will definitely come because these motors are I1 or below, which you have it in your plants. Also, these motors will be rewinded many times. Hence, there are also drop in efficiency or the efficiency losses due to that. And so these savings will be there. Only you need to tweak your system parameters as per the installation of new motors.
Thank you. Another question is for the EC program. Are the ECs properly tested and certified, and how reliable are they in the long run? And has there been any test done on the output efficiency of these ACs?
So I think this question is very interesting, and I will further add to this question later on once I answer this question. So basically, like any other equipment which is a star labeled by Bureau of Energy Efficiency, these air conditioners are also tested in the standard conditions, and only after the testing and verification any vendor can use the you know, the star labeling logo on the product. So yes, this AC has been tested, and we are, you know, continuously monitoring the performance of these ACs. And what we have also done is that we also inform customer about the buyback schemes when it comes to the air conditioners. So we also ensure that the old and used ACs are safely recycled. So I hope I answered your question briefly.
Yes.
And just to add to it, we also have, so most of the time the Bureau of Energy Efficiency also does check testing. But for this program, we have also asked Voltas, and our employees have also witnessed the testing at a third party laboratory, and we have witnessed ourselves, and the ACs were found to be, working perfectly fine. And the ISER value was, if I can say here, it was even higher than 5.4 in one of the check testing we have conducted.
Okay, thank you. So the last question we have here is, are there any other appliances other than AC and motor which ESL is focusing on or plans to focus on in the future?
So as of now, ESL has, as Garnaisa has mentioned, we have several programs, and recently, we conducted a pilot project in our own building on indoor air quality. So that could be a future program, and we are working on it. And we have been working also on a national chiller efficiency program since last year. And in coming like a quarter or by this year end, we will launch this national chiller efficiency program. So these are the two programs which we have already in preparation. There could be another several other programs which is still being incubated in EESL.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Anant and Mr. Abhishek. This comes to our end of the question and answer round. Now I would like to invite Mr. Manoj Kumar to give the word of thanks, please.
Thanks, Sumita. So it was a very interesting, and we got different perspectives from various panelists, be it Garnaik sir, Dr. Anant, and Mr. Abhishek. So the main objective or the purpose for such programs, conduct of such programs, is to establish a close interaction with all the stakeholders. This should not be a one-off affair. We intend to keep this as an ongoing dialogue, and that is where we keep on insisting on reiterating that this should be an ongoing dialogue to get the needs of the individual industry, because the needs and requirements of different industries or commercial entities vary from one another. So with that objective, we are conducting similar programs, and as all the speakers have been mentioning, we are open for any queries, suggestions, discussions. Your suggestions are always welcome through phone, email, or any face-to-face meeting. So I once again thank all the participants and the panelists for joining this session, and please be safe during this time. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Manoj. With this, we have come to the end of the webinar, and the recording of the webinar will be shared with all the participants. We would also like to mention that after you switch off the webinar, you will be getting a feedback form. Kindly please fill the feedback form so we know And if you have any further suggestions, questions, or you want to contact any individual, you can get back to us and we can help you get in touch with ESL. So thank you.
Thank you, Sumedha.
Thank you.